millions of homes. A man loved a woman, a child it was born. It learned how to hurt, and it learned how to cry, like humans do. I'm breathing in, I'm breathing out. Oh, so slip inside this funky house. Oh, the dishes in the sink, the TV's in repair.
Hi, I'm Tommy Rocket, and welcome to the Tommy Rocket Show. We're here this evening with my co-host Peter Phipps and his very special guest, Gary Zebrun. Gary's an author, and we're going to be talking about his latest works. Peter, tell me how you came upon this topic.
Well, Gary's a neighbor.
Yes.
This is a Rhode Island story,
yeah.
And you know your neighbors. Actually, I worked with Gary at the Journal for many years.
Really?
So I'll give you a quick bio.
Sure.
He born in Buffalo. Went to Notre Dame.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Got a MFA from Brown, where you were a poet, right?
Mm-hmm. That's interesting.
And you became a novelist. We're going to talk about the three novels you've published and the one in your brain that you're working on. And basically, the theme is always issues surrounding gay men and as they live their lives. So tell us about the first novel, and that one's set in Providence.
It is. And it's called Someone You Know. It was published in 2004, and it's a good example of how a sense of place is really important to me in
right.
writing. And in this case, it's the city of Providence.
And were you living in Providence at the time, or just working in Providence?
I was living in Newport, and I moved to Providence about 15 years ago. And had lived in Newport for 20, 25 years before that.
So we're going to have a reading.
But I would come to Providence as a closeted gay man to go to the gay bars and to cruise, I guess.
Yeah. So give us more of the plot. The plot is
the main character is a closeted columnist for the Providence Journal. And he goes out to the West Coast to Seattle to a newspaper conference where he has an affair with a very handsome stock cliche firefighter for the night. And he gets back home and he finds out that this firefighter has been murdered. And that's one shock. And then he also discovers that the murderer is someone from Providence who's been shadowing him. Turns out he ends up threatening the main character's family and threatening him. So
you want to read a little bit? But we should say one thing. So not only is there this ominous sense that something bad's going to happen?
Yeah.
But there's really a sadistic serial killer
of
gay men on the loose in Providence.
Right, and
is the killer gay?
And the killer turns out to be a repressed gay man, or we don't really know if he's gay, but clearly I think he's probably a repressed gay man who is turning that repression into something horrific. You know,
just a side
in his life.
The inspiration to write this, did it come from personal experience, or did it come from something you knew about, or what was your inspiration to write this?
Well, I've always felt that when you live a secret life, as I did for a very long time, I didn't come out until I was nearly 50, and that it ends up twisting your you know, your sense of self. And it can be very, you know, damaging. And so I wanted to write a novel about someone who was closer to me, like the closeted columnist, but then someone who had taken that closetedness, that secretiveness, to an extreme of violence, of having it turn him into a kind of twisted, monstrous character who hates himself so much that
he becomes deviant.
He hates himself so much, and he hates that part of him that is gay, and he ends up, you know, turning that against other gay men, especially other gay closeted men, as a way of, you know, beating himself up, I suppose. Mm,
that's interesting.
But it's self-hatred. And as a, you know, closeted man, I think, you know, most, I shouldn't speak for all closeted men, but I think when you live with a secret that is so important to your life, you know, your sexuality, that it ends up really damaging your sense of self. And as I said, that's the, I suppose, the inspiration
of
that
book.
So, yeah, one of the things I loved about writing this book was I was able to write about Providence. And I'll just read a few minutes from a chapter called Prospect Terrace, which was, you know, back in the late 90s. It was one of the cruising places in Providence. In this chapter, the main character has just told his wife and daughter about what happened in Seattle and about the stalker. Instead of, he's so disturbed by it, instead of staying home with his family, he decides to go out. And what he ends up doing is he goes out and cruises. Even though, you know, all this is happening to him, he decides, no, what am I going to do? I'm going to go out and cruise.
So it's a form of acting out.
Yes, a form of acting out. In my rearview mirror, I watched her at the front of the driveway waving for me to come back inside. She looked like she had just stepped into a silent avalanche. I tried to convince myself I'd left to find him, but the truth was to find the killer. But the truth was, unbelievably so, I went out hunting. When I turned onto Hope Street, I noticed the bartender locking the door to the bistro Rue d'Espoir. He was young, 20-something, and his eyes were blue and beautiful. I remember them from the times he handed me a Bushmills. His name was Jonathan, and he'd studied Nathaniel Hawthorne and Herman Melville. He's handsome. He never guessed that when I climbed into bed where Sarah was already asleep, I sometimes dreamed about him, his thick, light hair tucked under my chin. As I turned onto Benevolent Street, the buildings of Brown University emerged like the opening pan in a movie about love and loss. Red brick residence halls with stately chimney stacks and slate roofs and tree-lined quadrangles. I passed the deep blue and brown and red colonial houses, departments of geology, classical languages, Judaic studies, the painted Victorian ladies. More university offices, apartments, a neighborhood of consequence and comfort. Its beauty reached far back into the past. In summer, the blue jays spoke in Greek. At night, skunks pored over musty manuscripts. Sometimes I drove down these paths after 2 a.m. when they were empty except for young couples returning from Fellini's, the late night pizzeria in Wickenden. The occasional young man who would turn to look at a passing driver. I circled back and stopped at the sign on Hope and George. I felt it was the car. I felt I was in the car, dreaming about being in the car. A man carrying a white chocolate bunny the size of a two-year-old walked past. It had two York mints for eyes, round and black. George Street was empty except for a university security guard on his rounds entering one of the academic offices. He didn't seem to notice me meandering through the campus roads, Chesterfield and Benefit, John and Manning, Power and William, some of the houses older than America. At the corner of College and Prospect, someone in a black wool coat appeared in the moonlight. He looked at me as I drove past. I circled the block with feline patience, and when I returned to the corner, he was gone. I pulled to the side of the road, sat in the car to see if he or maybe someone else would walk by. In my rear view, I saw two young men in Patriots jackets headed up College Street, and when they passed the car, I smiled. "Go F yourself, fag," one said. The other ones took a stone from his pocket and hurled it into my windshield. They cheered and bolted. So I'll just stop there.
Very interesting. When did you begin to, how long had you written it that it became published? How long was the process beginning writing to publishing?
I think I started this probably 2 or 3 years before it was published. And then I had an agent who sent it to a lot of, to many of the big New York publishers, and it didn't find a home there. And eventually, a press called Ellison that published a lot of gay literary fiction, not just the kind of pulp fiction, took it. And but I had. It's about 2 or 3 years before it was published.
And you had, let me just, this was 2001?
2001, and I was still closeted at that time. I didn't come out to my coworkers at the Journal until a few months before the book came out.
Now, and you would write during the day because you were working nights, is that how it worked?
Yeah, I would get home at midnight and I'd get up at, you know, 9 in the morning, work and for four or five hours, walk my dog, go back to work, go back to the Journal and start the day over again.
Now, the book came out in what year, 2002?
In 2004.
And it was?
It became a pretty good success. You know, it sold a lot of copies, and it was a finalist for the Lambda Literary Book Award. It was widely reviewed, so even though it was published by a smaller press, it had the reach of a New York publishing.
So this was 20 years ago.
20 years ago.
And what did you feel looking forward to your life as a writer at that point? It must have been a pretty confident, giddy view of the future.
Oh, no? It was great to have a first novel published at my age. I was 50 then, I think. And I had written, you know, as you said, poetry and published a good number of, when I was in my 20s, a good number of poems when I was in my 20s. And then I had written another novel about my Russian grandmother that couldn't find a home. And then I had sort of given up for maybe 15 years until I started this.
So when did you start your second novel, Someone You Know? Someone You Know is the name of the title you just read from, and the other one is called Only the Lonely. Yeah, so yeah. When did you start working on Only the Lonely then?
Oh, I think I started Only the Lonely just before this one was published in 2004.
Right.
And it's about a closeted gay character. There are two principal characters, Asim and Tariq. They are American Muslim brothers who grew up in Lackawanna, New York, whose father was an immigrant from Syria. And ran the theater in Lackawanna called the Bethlehem Theater.
Here's what I think we can do. we can take a break and get to the second book in the second segment, right?
That's a good idea. And we're coming to the end of the first segment, so stay tuned for the second segment of the Tommy Rocket Show. Thank you.
To bring it?
I forgot it.
Forget it.
Next time, don't forget it. And every time, make it part of the relationship.
A latex condom used consistently and correctly prevents the spread of HIV, the virus that causes AIDS, and may save your life.
Hi, and welcome back to the second segment of the Tommy Rocket Show. As you know, we're here with Gary Zebrun, author, and Peter Phipps. Peter, what were we blending into in the second segment here?
Well,
The second book.
For those who might have missed the first segment, you know, Gary's a novelist, and he's written, we're talking about the three published books. Second book is called Only the Lonely, which is the Roy Orbison song, and it's about two
Muslim
brothers living in Buffalo in right before 9/11.
Lackawanna. Which is part of Buffalo, more or less.
Right before 9/11.
Right before, okay, actually, so days before 9/11.
So set the brothers.
Excuse me. I think I when I there are two Muslim American brothers, Asim and Tariq. Asim is the younger brother, and he's 18, gay, ready to break out of Lackawanna, and head off to the University of Michigan. And his brother Asim, who's a bit older and is an extreme Islamist, a wannabe terrorist. In fact, he has just returned to Lackawanna from several months in Afghanistan, where he was training, and actually kicked out of the camp because he was so unpredictable. They didn't even want him as a possible terrorist because he was
the older brother.
This is the older brother. So the older brother is home. And so on the one hand, it's a story about these two brothers. And the an additional subplot of the story is that their father died recently and has left the movie theater, the Bethlehem Theater, to Asim to run. So that sort of puts a kink in his plans to go off to Michigan. He feels not only responsible for the theater, but responsible for his father's mistress, lover. His mother had been long dead. Sonia, who has Parkinson's disease, and he feels he has to somehow care for Sonia. And all of the characters, especially Sonia, tend to interpret their lives, live sort of sometimes alternate lives through movie characters that they've fallen in love with over time. So that's another part of the novel, and in addition to the brothers and the terrorist aspect.
And does the older brother know the younger brother is gay?
No, but he sort of suspects it, and is sort of Asim is very doesn't want to reveal that because he's afraid of what Tariq might do. But Asim becomes very worried about Tariq because he feels that he could he feels that he could blow and do something terrible in Lackawanna, like some kind of a terrorist attack in Lackawanna.
So that's the tension.
Do they live alone together?
With Sonia. She lives in the house, too. And they have a sister who also lives there. But anyway.
A reading.
I thought I would read a little bit about just a short passage that tells you, that shows you a little bit about
Is this the beginning of the book?
No, this is into the book. And Tariq has come home just a little while before this. And Tariq still wants to be a terrorist, and he's planning a terrorist act in Lackawanna. And Asim sort of suspects something, but doesn't quite know what's going on. When Asim got home, all the lights were out. He remembered that his sister was working the night shift. He walked upstairs and noticed Tariq's door ajar. There was enough light from the street so that he could tell no one was inside. One of the few times he had ever been alone in the room, he turned on a lamp clamped to the headboard and saw on the desk the note someone had taped to the Bethlehem Theater door not too long ago. "Okay, towel heads, open up the show." The scene was surprised that his brother Tariq had kept it. There was a drawing of hooded stick figures hanging, execution style, from trees, and a bowling ball bomb with a fuse dangling from the top. There was a postcard note, postcard-sized note, with the heading, "Don't be fooled by these Arabs. Krista McAuliffe, astronaut. Doug Flutie, NFL quarterback. Cindy Leitner, MAD co-founder. Jacques Nasser, Ford Motor CEO. Helen Thomas, White House correspondent." Tariq had written in, "Badru Zahid," that's their father, "movie house fool." And he calls him a fool because his father was very assimilated and he didn't approve of assimilating into American culture. Tariq did not approve of that. Below the names in bold letters, Tariq had written, "We do not assimilate." He sat on the bed and noticed a pamphlet on the edge near a pillow with three Arab children, two boys and a girl on the cover. He opened it and at the top was this invitation, "Adopt a martyr's child. For $50 a month, a child of Shahada could be given a life fitting for the smiles, a devotion could fitting for the sacrifice of a martyred parent. Imagine the clothes and sweets, the smiles a donation could bring such a parentless child." He heard a car pull in, and when he reached to shut off the light, the note and everything else fell to the floor. He groped for them in the dark and hurriedly put everything back. When Tariq leaned into the window, Asim bolted and reached his room before he heard the front door open. He sat on his bed, breathless, hoping Tariq had not noticed the light go out. He heard footsteps on the stairs and tried to think what he would say if Tariq stormed into his room. "Why do you call the old man, our father, a movie house fool?" he would shout back. He heard his brother's door creak shut. He heard a bureau drawer sliding. It was that quiet. Pajamas, he thought. Tariq never slept naked. Even years ago, before his brother knew he was gay, Tariq told him, "When you shower with other boys at school, you shame your family." Tariq walked back down the hallway to the bathroom. Asim heard water running in the sink. The toilet flushed. He imagined his brother bare-chested like Renan in the 007 movie, but even more handsome. He listened for the bed springs. He heard chanting in Arabic, and after a few minutes, there was silence, and he knew that Tariq had fallen asleep. Asim stood and unbuckled his pants and let them fall to his ankles. He slid his briefs down and stepped out of them. He unbuttoned his shirt and threw it onto the chair. He sat and removed his socks. He admired his nakedness and knew he had grown into a body that a man would love to touch. He felt the shock of the cold sheet when he slipped his legs under the covers. He touched himself and whispered, "Dum-dee-doo-wa." He pictured Tariq, strong and handsome. He wished he were that rugged. He was just lonely in Lackawanna.
Now, there's background in your family with movie theaters, right?
Yes.
So you knew a lot of the inside stuff in movie theaters?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah. Because your father read
it. I loved growing up in the movie. Oh, yeah. My parents divorced, and I would spend, sometimes all day in the movie theater watching the same movie over and over and over again. Some of them I loved, others.
Was it like an RKO Albee theater?
Yes, it was a wonderful old theater in Lackawanna, you know, with the chandeliers and the carpet and, you know, the homemade popcorn.
What's the movie you remember the most?
When I was young, I loved Dr. Zhivago.
Who doesn't love that?
It was brilliant, and you know the scenes of the beauty. Those two are so beautiful.
The cinematography
and Christie and Sharif were just so gorgeous, especially you know when they would walk into that icicle house.
It was great. I forget the name of that town that house was in.
But I saw a lot of movies there that were the Unsinkable Molly Brown.
Did you see A Taste of Honey?
No.
That was in 61.
Yeah. Anyway, but I love the theater. Yeah. And so, yes.
What was your plan? Can we talk about the ending?
The ending of that? Yeah. What happens is that Tariq as I told you, he got kicked out of the Afghanistan training camp. And he's just a nitwit. And he decides that, coincidentally, just hours before or the day before 9/11 happens, that he is going to go into the theater and blow it up and blow himself up with a suicide vest. And I don't know if I should say any more than
that. No, don't say too much.
Yeah, but it that's the you're near the end of the book right there.
Yeah.
And if, mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the evolution of, like, if there's an evolution of the gay main character in my novels, is that the columnist in A Closeted Gay Columnist was truly closeted all of his life and, you know, ashamed of his sexuality had made it, you know, twisted. And in this novel, there is a character you sense is a little like him in Tariq, you know. His intolerance for whenever you have someone that intolerant of someone's homosexuality, you kind of sense, well, yeah, there must be more.
Right.
He must
but the brother
hate
was
something about himself.
The brother was not that way
about himself. And but Asim was just 18 years old, wanted to go to Michigan, wanted to fall in love. In fact, he meets a man in the book that he falls in love with. And even though it's a hidden relationship, it's much more, you know, optimistic, right, and heartfelt and fulfilling than the first character.
Well, it's interesting what you said, how self-hatred can make you do all these crazy things,
yeah,
you know, like even radicalize yourself,
yeah,
or something. But anyway, we'll get back to that when we come back for the third segment of the Tommy Rock Show, so stay tuned for these public service announcements.
Nice if latex condoms were automatic. But since they're not, using them should be. Simply because a latex condom used consistently and correctly will prevent the spread of HIV.
Hi, and welcome back to the third segment of the Tommy Rocket Show. As you know, we're here with Gary Zebrun, the author, and Peter Phipps. Peter, how are we transitioning here?
Well, we're moving on to Gary's third book called Heart Island, which is published this spring.
Yes,
and he's done, in the last couple of months, you've done readings and things around the country. But Heart Island, many people may not know what it is and what...
Tell us what it is.
How it functions in the book and in the history of New York.
Okay, a little bit about the history of Heart Island. It's the Potter's Field for New York City. It has been the Potter's Field for New York City for over 100 years. It's where all the indigent, unclaimed, unknown have been buried and are still being buried today. It's off the coast of City Island in the Bronx. It's shaped like a mini boot of Italy. It used, until recently, until maybe less than a year ago, It had been run by the Department of Corrections, and the burial crew was made up of five Rikers Island inmates. Now the Parks Department has taken it over, and they have professional burial crew members. But for decades, it had been these five inmates from Rikers Island. It's not the same five inmates, but every year there's a new group, because at Rikers, you're only in there for about no more than a year.
So who's buried there?
Well, a little bit of, I won't tell you too much about the history, because I might read a passage that includes some of that. But who's buried there? There are some famous people.
Unclaimed bodies.
Unclaimed bodies, yeah.
Child Broadway star or something.
Yes. Anyway, but there are very few people buried there who...
Other inhabitants had, there?
Pardon me?
Other inhabitants on the island?
The other inhabitants? Well, there are deer and insects. Oh. And
all right, so it's set there, or what? How does your book work on Heart Island? That's the title.
It's the title. The main character is Sal Cusimano, and he is the ferry boat captain who hauls the coffins and the burial crew from City Island to Heart Island, and the novel is about Sal Cusimano's two families. The family that he's formed on Heart Island with this burial crew and the dead, both the newly dead and the long time dead, the kind of relationship that he's formed, it's a kind of sanctuary for Sal. He sees it as a very productive, safe place to be. And his family back home on Staten Island, which is made up of his father, who was recently gunned down. He was a bookie for the mob. His mother, who is spiraling into dementia. His adopted brother, who used to be his next door neighbor, but when that boy's parents were died. The Cusimanos adopted him when he was about eight, and his name is Justin, and Justin and Sal became very good friends, and eventually in high school, they became lovers and have remained lovers well into their 30s now.
And when we get to the book, what is Justin's role?
When we get to the book, Justin has returned home after being away for a while, and he's become the local parish priest. And then there's another member of the family, Sal's blood brother named Anthony, who is a dirty, corrupt New York's Manhattan detective in the police department. So the novel tries to tell these two intersecting stories. One, the story of Heart Island, its past and present, and then Sal's family back in Staten Island. And the intersection happens very vividly one night when Sal's brother, Anthony, the dirty cop, calls him in the middle of the night and says, "I need your help. We have to take a body and bury it in Heart Island." And that's what they do.
One thing, the book, I'll tell you, it's very authentic. One of my favorite parts is just the sense of the boat in the East River, the currents of the pulling into this very difficult dockage. You get a sense of the rocks and the current. It's also very realistic when it talks about the bar in Staten Island and the mobsters and And you got that not through your imagination, but you went out and saw it, right?
I did. I became interested in Heart Island maybe almost 35 years ago when I was on the wire desk at the Providence Journal, and I saw a story come across about it. And it's always stayed in the back of my imagination, a desire to write about it. And then before COVID, I retired from the Journal, and I was able to get back to writing. So Heart Island is the first time I worked on a novel since Only the Lonely, so maybe 15 years. But anyway, I was lucky enough to get for the Department of Corrections to allow me to go with them on a tour of Heart Island one day, and then to I stayed on at an Airbnb on Staten Island for a couple of weeks to get to know the town. And I also did a ton of research about Heart Island, its long history. I could tell you that it's been home to Confederate soldiers during the Civil War, a jail for Confederate soldiers. There was once a house for, quote, wayward women. There was a prison for old, elderly lifers who were no longer a violent threat, who had their own little prison there. There was plans to build a, quote, Negro amusement park there at one time. Mm-hmm. In fact, some of those buildings went up, but they were quickly torn down because the Department of Corrections decided it would be too risky to have people come over to the island. They might bring contraband. It's the site of a Nike missile base, which protected the city from, during the Cold War, from the communists.
There's a lot to research.
Right. Yeah, it was fun doing that. And it's a really fascinating island.
And the priest is a very good man.
Yeah, the tension between the two brothers. So there is a connection to Only the Lonely, but in this case, they need to remain closeted, they think, because he's a priest, and but they have a very loving relationship, and there are people who know about them. They're good friends and
all. Is the book narrated to the eyes of the ferry boat driver?
Yes, mostly, but it also has, it moves from point of view to other characters too, some of the chapters. So there's a multiple point of view through Justin's eyes or through Anthony's eyes.
And there are ghosts.
And there are ghosts through the ghosts of the island's eyes.
Right. So you're very, the writer, you're very much in control of what the reader knows. It's not just what one character knows.
Yeah. Oh, yes. It's the third person, omniscient point of view of the author.
Let me ask you this. Before you went to Heart Island, had you had a good portion of the book already written?
No, none of the book was written until I came back. And then during COVID, when we were all confined, I really hunkered down and that year and a half wrote the novel.
Wow.
How about before we go to the next break, the final break, can you read about a minute or two just to get a sense of what's going on?
Yeah.
We have a couple minutes.
Maybe about a minute.
Read to the break if you can.
Yeah.
You got something short?
Let me see. I could read a real short passage about the two brothers.
Good.
Not much has changed in the bedroom Sal and Justin began to share 25 years ago. The bed is here that replaced Sal's twin, the queen that Ida and Francesco hauled down the steps of Justin's house next door and into Sal's room, so small there is barely space for night tables. Today, the lives of the saints on one stand, the perfect storm on the other. Gone are Sal's poster of the fedora-clad Michael Jackson doing the moonwalk and the Lord of Illusions movie bill, which was the only keepsake Justin insisted on bringing with him those many years ago. Still above the bed is the crucifix Ida found at the Salvation Army. Maybe I should end there.
That gets that's their bedroom. They share that bed.
They share that bedroom. Right. They've shared that bedroom since they were 8 years old. Yeah. And the priest, of course, there's no suspicion because this is where he grew up, and everyone thinks when he stays overnight at the house, he's staying with the family.
Yeah. Good. Well, we'll talk about those conclusions when we come back for the fourth and final segment of the Tommy Rocket Show, so stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Mike Farrell. We hear a lot about youth violence today, what's causing it, how to stop it. We now know that people who do violence to others often begin by abusing animals. Animal cruelty is serious business with serious consequences for all of us. If you see an adult or a child hurting an animal, please report it to the proper authorities immediately. A child who abuses an animal is often himself abused, and the cycle must stop. For more information, contact People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. Thank you.
Hi, and welcome back to the fourth and final segment of the Tommy Rocket Show. As you know, we're here with Gary Zebrun, author, and Peter Phipps, the planning potentiary of the Tommy Rocket Show. Peter, tell me what we're doing right now.
Gary,
we're talking about Heart Island.
Gary was reading from his new book, Heart Island.
Yes.
And we're going to continue with a little bit more on the characters and the place.
Yeah, and tell us what we're going to be, what part of the book you're reading from.
I just read a short graph about the two brothers at their home in Staten Island. And but now I'll read about the island, Heart Island itself. Okay. And the burial aspect of it. The five pine coffins stacked in the New York City Department of Corrections refrigerated truck are waiting to be transferred to Vesuvius's main deck, a light load for the week's first haul of the city's discarded dead. 4 days a week, New York City's deserted are hauled onto the ferry at City Island Dock. The indigent or unclaimed stillborn babies, bodies, and their dissected parts that had been donated to medical and mortuary schools under the one condition that cadavers and the remains would not be burned. The pine boxes were tagged in black marker with a name, if one was known, and a number. Today's funeral cargo, Jamal James, 042301, female unknown, 042302, Sally Winston, 042303, male unknown, 042304, Abraham Eisenberg, 042305. And then this graph, cell is at the handrail of the ferry boat named Vesuvius, and the crew begins to come to the dock. Inside the ferry, Sal leans against the handrail at the back of the wheelhouse and sees the DOC bus come through the gate and pull up to the dock. Officer Mary Hemmons is driving, her head barely reaching above the steering wheel. James Booker, the DOC sergeant in charge of the burial detail and all matters small and large on Heart Island, is first down the steps. He looks as breezy as his charges, five Rikers inmates. Sal watches as they place their sacks on the deck, all filled with lunch and water, some with paperbacks and magazines and packs of cigarettes. "Hey, Cappy," Jesus Ribol says, almost singing, waving to Sal. "Ain't it a kick-ass morning? Just five in the icebox. There'll be chilling on the island today, baby." Sal nods. Booker says, "All right, guys, get those coffins aboard Vesuvius." Did you want to?
So they're loading up, and there is a section in there where there's a lot. Booker is an emotional man, mm-hmm. and he hates it when there are babies, small coffins.
Yes.
And that's because he's just touched by it, right? Or
well,
and they do this every day, correct?
They do this 4 days a week. Yeah. In Booker's case, he hates to see all the babies because his wife was an addict, and their child died in childbirth.
Oh, that's right.
Partly because of his wife's addiction.
So it particularly bothered.
So it's really hard for him to see the baby. And one of the inmates, Jason, who was an NYU student, and the reason he got sent to Rikers was that he, during a hazing thing, he bought the drug, they kind of like an LSD that the freshman had, and the freshman ended up jumping out his window. So, but he in particular is moved by these by these small coffins. They're the size of shoeboxes. In fact, they call them shoebox. And there's a separate place on the island where they're buried. And unlike the adults are buried, 150 of them, in a long mass grave, three coffins on top of each other, and three or four coffins wide, depending on how many oversized coffins there are for bigger corpses.
And the gay theme.
Pardon me?
The gay theme through the novel.
The gay theme.
The gay theme, does it travel through more than just one character?
No, actually, the only gay character in, but one of the no, the only gay character is Sal
and Justin,
and Justin, of course, is the couple.
And yeah,
it's not, but there's a sense of the gay presence on the island because it was the burial ground in the early years for
AIDS victims.
For the AIDS dead, because and they were buried in 30 feet underground instead of 6 feet. Because people feared that we're contagious.
Now, at the end of the book, naturally, as you might expect, it comes back to Heart Island, right? And without giving too much away, how do the characters come back to Heart Island?
That's hard to say without giving too much of it away.
Well, you can say, can't you, that Anthony, you said already, knocked somebody off, right?
Yeah, there was a crime. Anthony ended up, that's not a huge surprise. Anthony ended up killing accidentally in a fight that had the son of a mob boss. And he fears what the mob boss is going to do, so they bury the body. But it's discovered, and there was a witness. And it ends up that Sel and his brother Anthony confront each other, and it ends tragically for both of them.
Yeah. Now,
it's hard to discuss a plot when you don't want to give it away.
You don't want to give it away. But let me just say, you have raised the issue of the dead speak as sort of a Greek chorus.
Yeah.
And one thing I particularly liked about the book was there's this very action-packed scene in the church, right? And then, which is sort of sort of traditional bit of writing, there's violence and things, but it ends with two or three chapters that are ethereal. Where the dead talk.
Yes, the penultimate chapter. All the characters is an occasion for all the characters to return to the island, which is a big surprise. I won't tell you why, but there's an occasion for them to do that. And then the final chapter is told from the point of view of the dead on the island, who usually like being left alone. But they're surprised by this burial that is different from all the burials that they know. And I guess I will read that that chapter. It's short. It's just a page. It's called The Neighborhood of Bones. When darkness falls on Potter's Field, the dead stir. They prefer Heart Island like this, empty of the living, free to listen to the night. Wind whistling, sea tide sloshing, leaves and branches rustling, hawks sweeping low, deer lollygagging across fields, squirrels, mice, and rabbits scurrying everywhere, and their closest companions, beetles and worms, feeding sedulously in the earth. Reverence weaving in and out of grave markers are their only annoyance. The ghosts slink their way through bones and dirt to prowl the chapel and workhouse, ball field and missile base, hoping for someone to haunt. Good riddance, the dead say, when the revenants flee. Once these dead lived in all your neighborhoods, in the Bronx, in Queens, walk-ups on Mott, Bleecker, and Christopher, on benches in Tompkins Park, Alphabet City, Harlem, and Washington Square. They died in Flatbush, Greenpoint, and Bedford Stuy, the Rockaways, and Ozone Park, on Mulberry Street, in Bensonhurst, Hell's Kitchen, and the Bowery. The dead breathed their last breaths without ceremony. A heart stopped with no one to resuscitate it, a brain hemorrhaged, a malignancy swelled. No one here is a stranger to hopelessness. They were poor and slept restlessly. No one died in a plane crash. Overdose didn't take long, just 5 minutes, sometimes less. And sometimes someone would lie dead for days before a neighbor, catching the scent of decomposition, called 911 and said, "Something's wrong next door." Many deaths didn't have to happen. But once you're dead, you say, what death makes any sense? The dead don't judge anymore. They made choices, advantages came their way or didn't. Some seized a moment, others let it slip by. The babies put into the ground, though, are tough, even for the dead, who wouldn't weep. The bones are so small, so inchoate. Still, what's done is done, and once the dead, young or old, are buried, depending on weight, sex, and the nature of the dirt, metamorphosis transpires day by day, and it isn't until the dead become bones in memory that they truly know the fellowship of the grave, the neighborhood of bones. I won't read the last graph.
Well, that's well written. I like it.
So I won't read the last graph because the last graph would give away the big surprise.
So one point to wrap up. You're working on a new book, set in Buffalo, and it has a lot to do with football.
It does.
But the thing that's really interesting that I just want you to touch on at the end here is that the character is out.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, gloriously out as a drag queen dancer for part of his the story. So that's a nice thing, right?
Yeah. He lives alone with his mother. This time his mother has Parkinson's disease, like Sonia did. He's a rabid Buffalo Bills fan. During a season when the pills for 10, 20 years were in the tubes, in the tank. But by day, he's a 911 operator, and every month, once or twice a month, he does drag at a local bar.
Ah, so there's
so he's out and celebrating his life.
So that's all. It's come a long way, these characters of yours.
Yeah, well, it's different than Hard Island.
Yes.
it sounds like you're constantly motivated to keep writing, and that's a good thing.
I hope so.
And I hope more continued success
for you. Well, thank
you. And thank you so much for coming on the show. And thank you, Peter, for finding this very interesting topic. And hope we can see you again.
Well, Tommy, thank you so much for the opportunity to be on your wonderful show.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm sure the viewing audience of Rhode Island has enjoyed it and looking forward to hearing more from you and Peter. And thank you very much for watching The Tommy Rocket Show. We'll see you soon.